that it doesn't take a mighty earthquake to shake the ground you stand on. 'Cause life can change like a hurricane and blow all the plans you planned on. Well, the ground is gonna shake and the wind is gonna blow. Now tell me,
Today's scripture lesson is from Psalms 136, verses 1 through 9. Give thanks to the Lord, for he is good. His love endures forever. Give thanks to the God of gods.
His love endures forever.
Give thanks to the Lord of lords.
His love endures forever.
To him alone who does great wonders. Who by his understanding makes the heavens, who spread out the earth upon the waters, who made the great lights, the sun to govern the day, the moon and stars to govern the night. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
Good morning, Acton Methodist Church. It's good to see everyone here this morning. My name is Wade. I'm one of the pastors of the church, and it's my joy to welcome you to this church, and so glad that you are here. If you are a guest of ours today, thank you all for being here. We know it's a really big deal to come to any church, and so we pray that you have a great experience of God's grace. We also want to make sure that we welcome those who are worshiping with us online. We want them to feel welcome also. And for those of you who are here every Sunday, thank you for once again deciding to be here. This is your church home, and we gathered in God's house to worship him. So we're glad that you are here this morning. When you walked in, we want to make sure that you got one of these. This is a worship guide. This not only gives you an order of worship for the day, but it also gives you some information that you need to know about. So if you want to open that up, then we will point out just a few things. As you do that, we do want to point out that we do have a special group that's with us this morning. This is the One Voice Choir from the University of Mary Hardin Baylor. And so they came in last night. Didn't they do a good job this morning? And that's a great way to begin worship. And worship is, we worship for an audience of one. And so they're going to help us go into that season this morning. They're going to sing for us several other times. And so we're glad that they are here. I actually have a vested interest in One Voice because I have a family member. I'll leave it to your imagination to see if you can pick out which one belongs to me. So it'll be a game that we'll play on that. So we're glad that you're here. Once you open up, you'll see a few things. One is you'll see an insert that looks like this, Spiritual Pulse. Don't do anything with that. Wait until the sermon, and I'll explain it a little bit later. And now that I said that, I know that you'll be looking at it when you hadn't paid attention to it yet, but that's okay. And then this half sheet of paper, this blue sheet of paper, that's an insert. We're wanting to make sure that if you are veterans of the armed services, we want to make sure that you are still connected. And that's one of the hallmarks of the armed services, that you're part of a brotherhood or sisterhood. And we want that to continue on this side of your military service. And so if you would, please write your name and email and phone number and drop this in the offering plates later in the service. Retired Master Sergeant Dan Loomis would love to contact you and to help you understand that you are not alone. And there are other veterans in this church and in the community that you can connect with so that no one falls through the cracks. So we would love for you to participate in that. You'll also see on the bottom right-hand page on the inside, you'll see congratulations and condolences are in order. One, for congratulations, Jeffrey and Betsy Ross on the baptism of their son, Judd Ross, today at the 9:45. We want to give God thanks for what is about to happen with that. We as Christ's body celebrate with those who are celebrating, but we also mourn with those who mourn. And so we want to offer our condolences to Heather Carmichael as she mourns the loss of her father, Michael. His services will be tomorrow morning at 2 at Wiley, 2 o'clock at Wiley tomorrow, so we want you to be aware of that. Also, you'll see when you walk out today that there is a big bus out there for the blood drive, and if you are willing and able to give blood this morning on your way out, we would surely appreciate that. We know that that will go a long ways, and so please keep that in mind. You'll also see that there's a new partner dinner that's taking place tonight, so if you've been dating the church for a while, it's time to go ahead and commit. Let's go ahead and make this a real relationship. And so we'd love for you to come and figure out what that means and ask any questions that you have and get to know the staff as well. Also, Discovery Weekend is coming up. And on the tear-off sheet, there's a way for you to serve and to help Discovery Weekend take off really, really well. And if you're not sure what Discovery Weekend is, it's a weekend from Friday through Sunday where really the senior high are pouring into the junior high. And it's a spiritual formation weekend, and they need some help. They need you to be praying for them. And you'll also see some other opportunities that you can provide, like opening your home as a host home. But, you know, it's great to want young people in the church. It's another thing to actually step forward and help that happen. So we know that there are some of you out there that your hearts burn for the youth of this community, and we know that you will step up and help in any way. The last announcement that we need to make today actually is going to be made primarily by Laura Wood. She is our SPR, or our Staff Parish Relations Team Leader. And so I want to invite Laura to come up at this time so she might make an announcement.
Thank you. Good morning, everybody. It's nice to be here today, and it was great to hear the fabulous choir. My name is Laura Wood Farrell, as Pastor Wade mentioned, and I am the current chair for the SPR committee. Just wanted to share that we did receive notification back from Bishop Lowry with the North District Office, and our pastoral leadership will remain in place with the exception of Pastor Margaret. Pastor Margaret, if you remember, went to a quarter time this past year. And serving Acton United Methodist Church. And this year she's gonna transition full time into her work at Project 44. So we're all excited that she's gonna continue to give back to our community in that way. She has shared her love, gifts, and discipline with our church family back since November of 2011. She will have her last day here at Acton United Methodist Church officially on the pastoral staff February 18th. We will be planning to celebrate and honor her with a reception. We're planning that now, and we'll have the date for that soon. And we're just excited. Pastor Margaret will continue to be part of our family, but just by serving through our community with Project 44. And I would ask everyone just to keep Pastor Margaret and her husband Ben in your prayers, and our church in your prayers at this time. So thank you, Pastor Wade.
All right, thank you, Laura. Margaret is much beloved here on staff, and I know within the church, and we're going to miss her being around, but we know that she's excited about her full-time ministry, and so it's a relationship change, but it's not a relationship break. We still love Margaret, and Margaret will continue. We'll see her in the community. So we're glad that for those of you who know her, we know that you'll want these next 3 weeks or so to be able to share your thanks for her and how she's impacted your life. So we're glad that everyone is here this morning. At this time, if you would please stand up and find someone you have not said hi to yet this morning and greet them with the love of Christ.
Well, I cannot imagine much of a better way to get entered to the Master's throne for prayer. Can you? This morning, as we go into our time of prayer, as we do every week, we set aside a time for silent confession. Because it's not something that we normally do in our day-to-day lives, is take time to confess how we've been pulled away from God, how we're not in alignment. So this morning, as we go to God in prayer, would you join me in a moment of silent confession? Would you join me in our prayer of confession? Lord Jesus Christ, Son of the living God, have mercy on me, a sinner. And friends, the good news is that in the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven. Glory to God. Amen. This morning we want to have a special prayer time, as we do every week, for a group of people. This morning, ones that are serving us every day. So this morning, as we see the faces, we remember the names of Justin Letbetter, Kelby Wiley, and Michael Murillo. We ask that you keep all the military, the families, in your thoughts and prayers. And now we come to a time in our prayer where we invite you to speak aloud your joys and your concerns, that together as a body we might respond, Lord, hear our prayers. So what are those things that we can pray for this morning? Lord, hear our prayer. 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 Eternal God, this morning we seek your face. We seek for what you're calling us to do and where you're calling us to go. We're seeking to go deeper with you, to choose your way above our own. So this morning we bring you our joys and our sorrows. We bring everything that has happened this week and everything that we did, the good and the bad. God, we ask forgiveness for where we have failed, where we have sought after personal glory and gain over love of you, where we have chosen to move away from you instead of towards you. God, we ask forgiveness. But God, we also know that we can claim your forgiveness this morning through Christ, with a sure knowledge that even before we could conceive of you, you were working on a plan for us, a plan to save us from ourselves, from the power of sin. Thank you, Lord. Thank you for all that we have and for all that you've given us. Help us to listen to you, that we may draw near and see what amazing things you are doing. God, we pray all these things in the way that your Son taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us of our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
We do indeed serve a generous congregation who is led by a generous God. And that was very evident last week when we announced that we were interested in starting a baby ministry, a ministry to give gift cards to new parents. Pastor Wade announced that at the services, and then we immediately had some donations made for a seed fund, and then we also had someone who even watched online and brought us gift cards. So that is just one example of the good and generous congregation that you are, how God is working through you and touching your hearts. And so would you join me in responding to that by saying the Apostles' Creed? Let us respond to God who loves us and is generous with that love. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. As we prepare to give, would you join me in prayer? Gracious and loving God, humble our hearts today as we prepare to give our offering to you. Take our hearts, take our gifts, transform them and make them yours. In your name we pray. Amen. Ushers.
Thank you.
may be seated. One voice, can we give thanks to God for them this morning? My goodness, that was awesome. So glad that everyone is here this morning. And once again, if you are a guest, I hope and pray that you have a great experience of God's grace today. And I hope you've already experienced that and will continue to do that while you're here on campus with us this morning. So this morning, I want you to think about how big is your God imagination. How big is your God imagination? I've been thinking about that this week, and I can tell you, I'll just be honest with you, that before I was born, I didn't think about God at all. It's pretty small imagination. And even after I was born, and I had nothing to do with that, but I was born, I can tell you that as an infant, I didn't think about God at all. And even as a child, when I thought about God, it was more like a superhero God. Because, you know, Superman and Batman and God, even though I went to church, God was like an awesome superhero. And so that was about the extent of my imagination. When I got to be a teenager, and how many of you have been teenagers before? Yeah, and there's just so much like going on within you, right? And in your mind, and even if you grew up in a church, you may have heard all the right answers, but when you're a teenager, it's hard to bring everything together. And so when I was a teenager or a young adult, you know, I would like to think that the imagination I had for God was based squarely on Scripture. But really, I found that when I was a young adult and teenager, a lot of times I made God into my own image. Didn't mean to. Just looking back, that's kind of how I imagine. Just like you all, you know, God is 6'10", right? And, you know, we all have that imagination, and that's the way it was when I was a young adult. But then, as a parent, you know, you kind of mature, and especially not just as a parent, but as you grow, hopefully your understanding of God, your imagination of God is more foundational than just kind of what your perspective is on that. So how big is your God imagination? This passage of Scripture that we're going to focus on today is actually in your worship guide, and it comes from Ephesians chapter 3. And this is, it's a way that Paul, the writer to the Christians in Ephesus, he's really putting a capstone on everything he's been talking about as to the enormity of God's grace and what that means for each one of us. And so if you have your worship guide in front of you, what I want to invite you to do is take a look at it. And as this scripture is read, I want to encourage you to either underline or circle those words or phrases that stand out to you. And if you have the YouVersion Bible app, you can also open that up and highlight those things as we read along. But scripture is meant to be participatory. It's not meant to be static. You're not just to sit there and absorb it and then let it go in one ear and out the other. It's the living, breathing word of God. And so I trust that either through what I say or in spite of it, God might get a hold of you this morning. So hear the word of the Lord. Now to him who is able to do immeasurably more than all we ask or imagine, according to his power that is at work within us, to him be glory in the church and in Christ Jesus throughout all generations, forever and ever. Let me read that one more time, because there's a lot that's packed in there. Now to him, God, who is able to do immeasurably more than all we ask or imagine, according to God's power that is work within us, to God be glory in the church and in Christ Jesus through all generations, forever and ever. Amen. This is the word of God for the people of God. Would you bow your heads and pray with me? Lord God, thank you so much for who you are, and thank you that you blow away our imaginations that we use to confine you. God, I pray that through these next few moments, just as you've already been working, that your Holy Spirit would move in such a way that it would stir us, that it would pierce our hearts, and it would transform our mind, and we'd get our hands and feet to working in response to who you are. And God, we pray that this will take place either through what I say or in spite of it. Lord, we are your people, and this is your house. May your kingdom come and your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. So in order to think about and really comprehend how big is your God imagination, It really helps to kind of break it down a little bit. I know it's helpful for me, and hopefully it'll be helpful for you as well. And to kind of navigate us through this, there's three things that we're just going to focus on. I'm just going to tell you straight up so you can kind of follow along with us as we go. We're going to focus on God's power in us, God's power through us, and God's glory in the church. Now, very simply, to understand the expansiveness of the imagination that we can have of God, we just need to look back as to who the character of God is in the first place. Before we even knew what was going on, God took the initiative and acted in our lives. How many of you have been baptized? Okay, at some point, even if you were baptized as a child, hopefully you got to the point where you were confirmed or you laid claim to the faith that your parents claimed for you. That's the vows that we take when we baptize a child. We will help raise them up in the church. But when we said those vows of baptism, we laid claim to the fact that Christ has already claimed us. And he's already done something in us. It's through Christ's grace that he's released us from this bondage of sin and slavery and shame. And in God's imagination, even when we could not imagine it, God broke into our neighborhood. That's what we celebrate at Christmas. Emmanuel, God with us. And so the imagination of God is so much greater than our imagination that the very first thing we need to think about when we think about our God imagination is that God has already done something in us. It's through the power of the Holy Spirit that his Spirit is testifying to our spirits that we are his sons and daughters. So let me put it a little bit more personally for you. Not just all of us, but for you. That Christ's Spirit right now is testifying to your spirits that you are a beloved son and daughter of the King of Kings. Doesn't matter if you had a fight with your loved one on the way to church this morning. Christ's Spirit is still testifying to your spirit that you are a beloved prince and princess of the King of Kings. If you've had a hellacious week this week where you haven't thought about God one time and you treated people like dirt and you treated your spouse in an unloving way, I still want you to know that because of God's imagination and how expansive his grace is, he's already doing work within you and testifying to you right now that you are a beloved son and daughter of the King of Kings, and that which you have settled for this week or this morning is not what you were confined to. God's imagination is greater. That's what Paul was trying to tell the Christians in Ephesus years ago. And I have found through my own personal experience, but also rubbing shoulders with church people for the last 20 years, is that we have a horrible imagination about the expansiveness of God's grace within us. We seem to forget time and time again that God's imagination is greater than ours and that which limits us does not limit him. And so we live lives with no imagination when we forget that God in his great grace and glory is already doing something within us. It's our job now to respond to that. And not just that God is doing something in us, but God is doing something through us. This is what Paul was trying to tell the Christians in Ephesus. That it's not just enough to be saved. How many of you are thankful that you were saved by grace through faith? As Methodists, we can be a little bit more enthusiastic about that. How many of you are excited that you've been saved by grace through faith? Amen. You don't have to be shy about that. We're at church. This is the one place where we can celebrate. Don't be shy about it. But we also need to know that we don't just have an insurance policy about the eternal fires of hell, but that Christ and his imagination is doing something through us. This is what Paul was trying to tell the Christians in Ephesus. That God's imagination is such that he doesn't just want you to know that you are a beloved son and daughter of his, but he wants you to know that you are useful for how grace can be manifested throughout this world. That you are his representatives, that you are his ambassadors. That when you speak and you claim the name of Christ, you speak on his behalf. When you walk into a room, you walk in on his behalf. That the imagination of God is that he can work even through the most earthly of vessels. And I won't point out anyone in particular in here, but we're all earthly vessels that God can work through all of us. That's part of God's imagination. That he doesn't put limits on people like we do. When I started a church down in Cedar Park 10 years ago, there were a lot of church pastors that were starting churches down there. And there were some pastors who came down And they had better resources than I did. They had more people than I did. They had actually land and a building more so than I did. And they had everything about them that on the surface you would look at and go, God is going to use them in a mighty way, and this thing is going to blow up in a really positive way. And then after 6 months or a year, they weren't around any longer. But then you would have people come in who couldn't preach themselves out of a paper bag, had poor personal skills with people, could not organize anything, and you look 6 or 9 months down the road, and that church has just blown up in an extraordinary way. On the human side, you can look at that and go, wow, I'm pretty envious of all that. But the faithful side says, look, God can work through the most earthly of vessels. He's not looking for perfection. He's looking to perfect those who make themselves available. That's the power of God through us. Last week we talked about the opportunities that we have as a church to be able to serve one another and to pray on behalf of the church, on behalf of other people, and to be a part of things in a lot of different ways. And a lot of times we go, I can't pray, and I don't want to serve. That's someone else's job. And I don't want to witness, and I don't want to give. And you think about all these limitations as to why you will not do something. But can I just tell you, by the grace of Jesus Christ, it's not just for your benefit. It's because God in his imagination can work through the most earthly of vessels so that his kingdom would come and his will would be done, even when you might stammer through a prayer. Even when you might show up on a Sunday morning and not really be feeling it. Even when you give and you're begrudgingly doing it. Even when you serve and you serve because you feel guilty when you don't. Even through all of those experiences, God can do something through you that you might otherwise limit yourself at. And then Paul continues and says, it's about God's glory in the church. That you all, for example, we all, are not just a part of Acton United Methodist Church. We're part of Christ's body. And Paul was telling the Christians in Ephesus that God's imagination is such that he can work through even this body and multiple bodies around the world that's called the church that sometimes seems a little bit broken. That sometimes in church world, we're cannibals. We eat one another. And we chew each other and spit each other out. And sometimes that can happen. But Christ is, in his imagination, is redeeming this whole thing. Because he's the head of the church, and it's there where his glory is found. This is the imagination of God, that God can work in and through the church of Jesus Christ. So I want to ask you this morning, what is your spiritual pulse? When you think about this imagination that you have of what God can do, what is your pulse on things? And when you're just thinking vaguely, you go, well, I'm feeling pretty good. But when you break it down specifically, it might change a few things. So if you would pull this out right here. It says spiritual pulse. Now, as you do this, this is not definitive. You will not find this exact replica of this page in the Bible. Okay, this is a tool that we're using to gauge the spiritual pulse. And this is my hope as a pastor. Is that every quarter, so that's about every 3 months of the year, we as a church will take our spiritual pulse. You will do that individually, and we will do it as a church. Just to see where you are, in another way, kind of gauging your God imagination. How is God working in and through you, like Paul was trying to tell the Christians in Ephesus? So, for example, we would love to have your name and your email address and your phone number, but we also understand that for some of you, there's no way if we asked you to put your name on it, you would ever turn it in. Because you're really making yourself vulnerable, and I understand that. If you do put your name, I want you to know that it's really just the pastors who are going to see that. We're going to look at it as a tool as to how we can come alongside you and help you move from one stage to another. However, if you don't want to do that, we would still love for you to turn it in without your name and phone number and email. I think it will help us gauge kind of where we are as a church. So, for example, when Paul says the glory of God through his church, that needs to take us back to the vows that we took when we joined the church. Y'all help me out here. When you joined the church, you said you would support the church with what? A little bit. Come on now. You said you would support the church with what? Y'all kind of petered out there at the end, but it's prayers, presence, gifts, service, and witness. And I thank you that you took that vow. So when you look at this, you're taking your spiritual pulse. And for example, you're saying, look, I will pray for Acting United Methodist Church because that's a vow that you took anyway. It's about the imagination of God intersecting with your imagination. And for some of you, you're going to respond, I love praying every moment as a lifestyle to the Lord. Others of you are going to go, look, I have set times during the week to pray. Others of you, for example, are going to pray. I'll pray during emergencies, but it's still a mystery to me. And others of you are going to put, praying is for other folks, not me. And then some of you are going to want to add something out to the side because those four options don't really fit you. But you're taking a spiritual pulse. And it's helping you understand where you are in this whole understanding of God's imagination. If you look at presence, I will be present and acting United Methodist Church. For some of you, you're like, when the doors are open, I'm there, enthusiastically. This is the church of Jesus Christ. We are part of the resurrected Savior. This is not just Acton Methodist Church. This is the church of the resurrected Savior. So some of you are going to be here every time the doors are open. Some of you are going to be asking, do I need to be here more than 2 to 3 times a month? Some of you are going to say, I'm pretty busy. Once a month is about all I can do. And others of you will say, I'm still wrestling with whether or not I really need to attend church. And once again, some of you may go, those four don't fit me. I want to write something else out there. Go for it. It's your spiritual pulse. Also, when you look at give financially to the Acton Methodist Church, some of you are going to give a tithe because you have been blessed by the Lord. Some of you are going to go, look, I'm not going to tithe. But giving to the church is the first thing I do with each paycheck. Others of you are going to go, I'll give, but it's the last thing I pay with each paycheck if I have anything left over. And others are going to honestly say, look, I don't think about giving at all. I just expect when I show up to church, everything's going to be there. Lights are going to be on. Heating, air conditioning is going to work. Donuts are going to be there. That's just kind of where we are on that. That's taking your spiritual pulse, God's imagination intersecting with yours. Also, I will serve Acting United Methodist Church. Put me in, coach. I'm ready to play. Some of you are like, I'm ready to just go wherever. Send me. Let's do it. Others are like, if no one else steps up, I will do it. Some of you are like, well, that's someone else's job. And some of you are like, I need more info. And then lastly, with the witness. I will witness to others what God is doing in and through Acting United Methodist Church. And some of you are going to say, look, I will share on Facebook what God's doing through Acton Methodist Church. I know some of you do. Others of you are going to say, look, I have neighbors I will invite. That's a big step. Others of you are going to say, engaging strangers is super fun. Right? Yeah, okay. And then some of you are going to say, I'm really nervous about this part. And there may be a fifth option that we don't know about. But the reason I'm bringing this up to you is when I ask you, how big is your God imagination? If you keep on finding yourself at the fourth block in each section, then I just want to come back to you that in response to God's grace in you, your imagination has become really, really small. Because you're thinking that your limits limit God. You may be like an infant that has no imagination of God. You may have a child whose imagination of God is that he's a superhero. Your imagination of God may be like the young adult or the preteen who's got so many things going on and you've really made God into your own image. And what limits you limits God. And then some of you, your imagination of God is so expansive because of the work that God is doing in you and because of the work that God is doing through you and because of how God wants to glorify the church. Later today, we're going to send an email out to everyone in the church whose email address we have, and we're going to send an electronic version of this. And it would be a high honor if you would complete that, and you would send it back in. We'll also post it on social media so that you can access it there as well. We want to use this as a tool to gauge where we are as a body of Christ. How much are we rooted in Christ? And how big is our imagination? Will you share your imagination with us so that we can imagine God in ways that we cannot even think about right now? We need your help. Will you help us? Let's pray. Lord God, thank you so much for your grace and thank you for your mercy. And God, thank you that you are so much bigger than what we can even imagine. Now, God, I pray that you will pierce our hearts and that you will indeed transform our minds and that your love will cast out all fear so that we can go where it is that you are leading us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. As you consider how you might respond to taking your spiritual pulse, and that really is an invitation to discipleship. As you consider what that looks like for you, would you please stand as we prepare to leave this place and as we sing our closing hymn of praise?
Amen. As we leave this place and we re-enter the world, what is our mission? Through the guidance of the Holy Spirit, we seek to glorify God, lead others to Christ, nurture disciples, and serve others in Christ's name. And all God's people said,
I should fall into